can all hear me?
Oh, yeah,
okay.
We can hear you.
Right, yep. Thank you. So I thought I'd get elected for that meeting. I'm going to do this and then run back to that meeting. So this is for you guys, the Board of Education. I guess you have gifts at your place.
We do. Thank you very much. That's very
Whereas an excellent public school system is vital to the quality of life in this community and fundamental to preserving a strong democratic society now and in the future, and public schools are being held to higher standards of accountability than ever before at both the state and federal levels. And whereas the members of the Woodbridge Board of Education represent an invaluable resource in this community as local decision makers responding to the challenges of assuring our school meets these higher standards. And these school board members must formulate policies to assure that all children learn to their fullest potential. Whereas these board members continually strive for improvement and progress with an understanding of the need for commitment to the higher standards of student achievement and are working diligently to assure that our young people are educated and prepared for the future. And whereas the men and women elected to these positions deserve recognition and thanks for their countless hours of volunteer service to public education and the children of our community. Now therefore, the Woodbridge Board of Selectmen and the Woodbridge School District thank all members of the Woodbridge Board of Education for their tireless and devoted service to our children, our schools, and our community, and urge all residents of our community to join us in expressing appreciation to these exemplary public servants and hereby designate March 18th, 2019 as School Board Member Day. So thank you.
Thanks, you don't get a lot of the times, but thank you for all of that. There's a small token of appreciation sitting in front of you, both to write on and to enjoy perhaps as a dessert after the meeting tonight. So thank you, board members, very much.
Okay, so we are going to go to the salute to the flag. The flag is back there.
We actually have our news program.
We do.
Oh. Yeah,
we're going to
skip that tonight. Sorry. Okay. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Correspondence? Do you have some correspondence?
Yes,
in our,
we did. We had two emails this month. Sent to the board, one from a teacher, one from a community member, both regarding the same event. not sure how much to get into it right now, but I think we will be talking about it more.
It's in the agenda.
It is in the agenda, okay. So they're in here, but basically talking about FMLA and sick leave and whatnot. So.
And I think we have some people here to talk about that.
Yes, we'll hear more about that.
Yep. So we're going to go to public comment. Everybody who wants to make a public comment, I don't know if you had a chance to sign up over there, but if you didn't, you know, you should still, you know, go over and sign up if you want to speak. And I'm just going to read our standard information about public comment. The board welcomes public participation. We ask that speakers please limit their comments to 3 minutes. Please be aware that the board will not respond to any comments made during the public comment period except to clarify issues, but we will take into consideration your comments and when appropriate, district administration will follow up with you at a later point in time. Did you have a question?
I had a question about the correspondence.
Yeah.
Can we comment on the correspondence that we received and indicate plans to discuss at further meetings?
We can indicate that we have plans to talk about that at a time in the future.
Okay. I think that's important to acknowledge.
Okay. Point of information, there was some question about whether public comment is permissible for only community members or for all public.
Woodbridge residents.
Woodbridge residents. Okay. All right. So. We should proceed with public comment. I don't know who's first on the list. I have a feeling it's a long list.
And can we make sure that mic is actually on?
Yeah.
I'm not sure when Beth was speaking that was actually on. It is on. Okay. Give us your name and your address in town. That'd be great. Okay. The first one is Gina? No? Carmelli? Okay.
Lena.
Lena. I'm so sorry.
Lena. This is Nina.
Okay. Hello. Good evening. I'm Nina Carmelli. Full address?
Yeah.
Okay. From 144 Peck Hill Road, Woodbridge.
That's good.
Awesome. So, I'm here to talk about MAG. I graduated here in 2016, somewhere around there. So, MAG shaped me into the person I am today. Not only did it make me into a better person as a whole, but it formed lifelong relationships and friendships, especially with the passionate and caring teachers of MAG. Also, it made me into a better citizen. For my bat mitzvah, I walked and raised money for the Walk Against Hunger, a yearly MAG event. MAG also opened me to my artistic and musical abilities. Mr. B was the first person who offered me to join the strings ensemble. Since then, I've been playing the violin for 8 years. MAG also led me to participate in the middle school musical during morning meetings. It helped me create confidence for singing and having a voice in the community. MAG also got me interested in science. I was always a curious learner, but MAG allowed me to use this curiosity to discover and learn new things by hands-on learning. Last week, I was actually in the Connecticut Science Fair, where we won first place for the Physical Sciences Award, and I don't think I would be able to do this without the motivation and the drive that MAG was able to give me from hands-on learning and to put my curiosity into somewhere to, yeah. Overall, MAG really has made me the person I am today, and I don't know if I would have had the same experience if it had been any other way. Thank you.
Thank you. Azi? Thank you.
I'm Nina's father. Same address in the record.
Okay.
So I'm also here to talk regarding MAG. So I'm going to echo my junior's comments here. So we've been members of the MAG community for, you know, about 8 years now. And We're concerned about the upcoming changes. We're concerned about what we heard is the school's view of how to deal with MAG in lieu of the, you know, the economic concern, and we wanted to echo, you know, to make our sentiment shared with the board here. For us, the MAG is more than just, you know, a program. It's one of the reasons we actually still live in this town. A few years back, I took a job in California. One of the reasons that we decided to actually stay here is not just the school system here, but it's MAG specifically, because we think it's a unique program and want to make sure that it's not just, you know, maintained, but it's strengthened. We were hoping to see actually a fifth and sixth grade, you know, adding to MAG and not just staying course. And we're concerned by the threat or the risk for the program by not making sure that the right person is coming to join the group. What I do for a living, I'm an HR. And when you have a group that works together as a team, you need to make sure that you bring someone that can complement the team and make it successful, and not allow financial concerns, you know, drive the decision. And we want to make sure that it stays as is. The last time I was here, it was 3 years ago, and actually Nina was awarded with your award, and there wasn't a showing like this year. I think one of the reasons that there's a showing like that here is because, you know, there's a lot of concern around that program. And one of the things I'm very proud of Nina, and I hope, and I have another daughter that's in the program now, and I have a younger son that I hope will be part of this successful program in years to come. And we want to make sure that it's continued to be as good and successful as it is. We're very sorry to see Mr. B leaving, and we think that he's obviously a cornerstone of the program. And want to make sure that the second person, you know, the person who succeeds him will be as good, if not better than him. And we want to make sure that the focus is on the talent and not on the budget aspect of that. I will finish my comments with, you know, being, I think what makes the program, the MAG program, as unique as it is that it educates the kids, the children, the young teachers, as they call, to be the change that they want to be in the world. And that's what's special about this program, and we want to make sure that it's sustained. We are actively members of this community, and we want to continue being members, and we don't want it to see it impacted negatively. Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Juliet?
Yes.
Oh, sorry.
Hello, my name is Juliet Bonazzoli, 41 Tumblebrook Road, Woodbridge, Connecticut. I'm actually here on two separate issues, both of which are on the agenda. So I'll start with MAG, since that's been the subject that has been discussed so far. My children, my older boy, Giovanni, is a MAG ancestor. My younger one is now first grade MAG. My older boy also had Mrs. Franklin for sixth grade. MAG and Mrs. Franklin are why Beecher Road School is what it is today. My son, who is entering high school, is an honor student, straight A's, advanced classes, wins character awards constantly, just won the eighth grade integrity award. He is all of those things in part because of MAG and because of a teacher like Mrs. Franklin. MAG is a remarkable program. It's a active learning philosophy that I couldn't begin to articulate as a teacher, but it is a hands-on learning experience, as you've heard at least one student share. It is a coalescence of energy between teachers that must operate in unison. Mr. B, its founder, is retiring, which makes me want to cry, although he certainly deserves to do so at this point. He is a brilliant man. He will be very difficult to replace. I've pondered at times what motivates a man like Mr. B, of his intellect and character, to want to remain an elementary school teacher and dedicate his life to that. I believe the answer is simply that he embraces young minds and wants to shape them into the future, and realizes this is a critical period in their lives. So he has dedicated his life to this. The MAG teachers, as I said, it's a synergetic interaction between them. It's critical that they are involved in the hiring process. You are going to need a budget that can find someone as qualified as Mr. B, and it is absolutely essential that the MAG teachers are involved in the hiring process, because this is a group that the value of what they teach is that they all interact and grow from each other, including the students and the teachers. I hope that you will continue to share information with us. Let us know what's going on. As MAG parents, obviously we are very concerned. We want to make certain you hire someone of the caliber of Mr. B and that our teachers are directly involved in the process, so that we can ensure the dynamic that they have right now continues to exist. And just as a testament to MAG, my son's first year in MAG, we were in Stop and Shop getting groceries one day in the vegetable aisle and talking about MAG, his day at school. A young woman, about 20, walks up and says, I'm sorry to interrupt, may I share something with you? And I said, certainly. She looks at my son and says, I'm a MAG ancestor. MAG will change your life. Keep your head up, keep your mind open, and your heart open. And to this moment, her words will always resonate with me. This beautiful young woman, about 20, confident, who just overhears a conversation, is a MAG ancestor, and walks up to me to say how remarkable MAG is. It is enduring. Please keep it that way. Now I'll talk about Mrs. Franklin. I'm sure you all know Mrs. Franklin is in the process of adopting. She's a remarkable teacher. It has come to my attention that because she's adopting, she is not being treated the same as a woman who gives birth through another means. I've sent in a letter. I don't know if you all are privy to it. I believe that unless you broaden your application of maternity, that you're opening a Pandora's box of problems. It is very unenlightened to think that a mother who adopts, which is an equally arduous process to childbirth, is in some way not deserving of maternity leave. Worst case scenario, which I could, I'm sure this is a matter of first impression for all of you, so I hope that you err on the side of enlightenment. But worst case scenario that I posited was under your application of the word maternity, you could have a surrogate mother who is nothing but an incubator. It is not her sperm or egg in her. She gives birth at the hospital, leaves the baby, goes home, and is on maternity leave. That is incomprehensible. Maternity leave is about the bonding process between child and mother and family and acclimating that child to its new life with its family. Whether that child came from you from a birthing process or through adoption, it is the same thing that we are all striving for. I hope that as you reevaluate this, that you do consider that adoption, if it's an antiquated interpretation of maternity to think that it should only apply to childbirth. Thank you.
Thank you. Wanted to speak first. You want a Kim? Okay.
My name is Kim Franklin, and I'm a sixth grade teacher here at Beecher Road School. I've been a teacher here for 4 years. Superintendent Award. Tonight, I'm here before you for a very different reason, but one that has to do with adoption. I'm here because the superintendent informed me that my leave due to adoption would not be treated the same as if I was giving birth to a child and afforded the minimum time of six weeks paid leave to allow me to bond with our new son, Lap. I never anticipated that adoption would be treated so discriminatory compared to a teacher who has the fortune to bear a child physically. The superintendent of our school has told me that I would not be honored the same paid time off that someone who delivers a child through childbirth because of the absence of language that addresses how to respond to a teacher who is adopting concerning paid time off. I was told I would be paid 2 weeks of family medical leave that would come out of my sick bank, so long as I plead my case about the emotional need of the child. Beyond these 2 weeks, I would not be paid, but my job would be protected under FMLA. Other parents who give birth can deplete their entire accumulated sick bank or sick time, if so needed, up to 6 weeks, as it is covered as a disability. With my two girls, there is no question that I needed time to heal. However, what happens during the initial months with the child goes beyond the physical process of healing. It is much more about bonding and nurturing. This bond with my daughters was already built in before they were born. Bonding will not be innate for Lap. There is nothing innate or natural about being taken from your native language and people to then be forced into the arms of a stranger. I know because I was adopted at the age of 4.5 years old, stripped of my given name and placed into the household of people that did not speak my language. I know that without my parents' full availability, I may not be here today as a member of the Beecher Road School community, of which I take great pride. I am the third oldest of 15 children, 11 of whom were adopted. I witnessed firsthand the terrible pains of my mother, who miscarried twice, but this did not stop her from expanding her family through adoption. I participated in the caretaking of many of my siblings and watched firsthand the transition and bonding process that was essential to the care of a child, biological or adopted. Since I informed the administration in February about my need to leave to go to Vietnam in April or May, I have not slept, lost weight, and have experienced emotions of deep sadness and anger. I assure you this is not because of worries about my pending adoption. It is because of the implicit bias that I have experienced in sharing this news with the administration of our school. The first reaction to my news was, quote, "I don't know how to deal with this," end quote. I never assumed that I would be treated as an other because of adoption. Defining family differently because a family chooses or has to expand their family through adoption is discriminatory. Defining family differently because the child is not physically delivered vaginally is archaic and no longer the makeup of Beecher Road School community of families. Many Woodbridge families have adopted children or know a family who has an adopted child. No longer are the days when families are defined by the standard mom, dad, and biological children. I moved with my family in 2012 to Woodbridge because I saw a community that was changing and that had other families who shared my value of family. I chose to teach at Beecher Road School because I thought it embraced a culture and a climate that was student-centered and supported its teachers. But as a school and as a community, we speak of embracing diversity. These actions do not suggest we support diversity. To assume that someone who adopts can come back to work after two weeks is unrealistic. And someone who possesses this thinking is uninformed of the process of adoption. My family will need to be in Vietnam for 2 weeks before we can even bring Lap home. I assume naively that the school would recognize this and honor the time to allow the transition of Lap into our family and into our community. This decision to not honor me pay for my accrued sick time, time that I have earned, bears consequences on many levels. By choosing not to allow me to utilize my accrued sick time like a person giving birth sets a precedence as to how we define family and parenting. This decision to choose to care for some teachers and not others creates a climate that goes against the mission and vision statement of Beecher Road School that was spearheaded by the superintendent and agreed upon by you, the Board of Education. The mission of Beecher Road School states, Beecher Road School is a caring, creative community that models and inspires the joy of lifelong learning, embraces diversity, and celebrates the unique qualities of each person. It goes on to emphasize the importance of educating the whole child. Treating my leave differently goes against the language of diversity. Is Lap not entitled to be a whole child? This decision to not honor me pay for my accrued sick time equal to the minimum granted to a person who physically gives birth affects not only my family, it affects the community of teachers and the community at large. This affects so many other people who might come after me and people who might not have the voice to express how incredibly discriminatory this decision is to not honor a teacher the same minimum benefits of a parent experiencing childbirth. This recognition that families should be afforded to parent regardless of how a child physically becomes a part of a family recently led New York to adapt their language to be more inclusive. As of January 2019, the state of New York honors paid family leave of up to 10 weeks, providing paid time off to, quote, bond with a newly born, adopted, or foster child, end quote. The United Federation of New York Teachers, UFT, was ahead of the state of New York, and as of June 2018, changed the language in their contract to allow paid parental leave of up to 6 weeks to its employees, quote, following the birth, adoption, or foster care placement of a child, end quote. So I ask you, are we going to wait for the state to become more inclusive before we consider to change the language to recognize parental leave and not hide behind physical disability? Are we going to be school number 120 or 1,020 to follow behind New York City? I would hope that we would be proactive and make the change to be inclusive now and embrace our community of families and not wait for this to be forced down upon us. I believe it is not within us to be passive because of what is in or what is not in a contract. The contract is flawed, but we should not be flawed. If we choose to go the route of behind the physical disability language of the contract, we ignore our mission and vision statement. If we honor the mission and vision statement only for some children and not for others, the school will have actively carried out actions that are discriminatory against Lap before he even steps foot into our school. The final thing I would like to reiterate is that the decision to not provide paid leave was made based on language that was absent in the contract, as nothing in the contract speaks about how to handle adoption except for FMLA. However, the contract also does not state that I cannot be paid for the 6 weeks, as would be afforded to a parent giving birth. Therefore, it seems only reasonable that we do the right thing and honor me equity in paid time of 6 weeks, recognizing that parenting is all the same no matter how we bring a child into our family. By doing this, we are recognizing the need to change how we respond to family leave and taking steps to become inclusive of our changing community. By doing this, we are embracing diversity. By doing this, we are honoring the whole child. To share with you how this decision has impacted adoptive families, I have letters from the adoption agency, and from parents who have adopted, from our own faculty and our own community of members that feel our actions and language needs to embrace a culture of inclusivity. I hope that you take the time to read these letters because they are educational, insightful, and broaden my understanding of adoption and our core values as a community. So thank you for honoring me the time.
These are letters from families, both in our community who have adopted and abroad. It is also from faculty members who have adopted children. Thank you so much.
Back to follow. Superintendent Gilbert, members of the school board, my name is Annabelle Malabago-Fine. I've been a Woodbridge resident since 1996. I live here on Beecher Road. My husband and I put 9 kids through the Woodbridge and Amity school system, including 4 through Beecher Road School. We have 15 children, 11 of whom are adopted from all over, including my stepdaughter Kim, who teaches 6th grade here, as you know, at Beecher. We were excited when we heard that Kim and her husband Shane would be adopting a 7-year-old boy from Vietnam. We know from experience that adoption is not easy and takes an enormous amount of love, effort, and time, including traveling time to the country, a requirement for most, if not all, adoptions that happen internationally. We were absolutely shocked when we heard that Beecher does not currently have language that would allow for paid leave of absence for somebody who is adopting a child. And even worse, that Kim would only be allowed to use 2 weeks of her banked paid time versus a birth mother who would be able to use up to 6 weeks of paid leave. That is unheard of in this day and age where adoption has become far more common than it ever was. What's even worse is that Kim has to provide evidence to the superintendent to justify that this time is even needed because there's no current policy, and it's up to the superintendent to solely decide if he will allow her to use those 2 weeks of her bank paid time. I'm not quite sure you're aware of what it takes when you bring and adopt a child home for the first time. It's not like going to the shelter and picking up a dog, and you put it in a room so you can go back to work the next day. This is a child who needs to bond with his parents. It's not a natural bond, as you heard from Kim. It's one that takes a far greater effort to create, develop, nurture a bond with an adopted child. The child needs to feel safe, loved, cared for, comfortable in his new home, particularly in an international adoption where with an older child, by the way, where the child doesn't speak English. Adding a child to a family, whether by natural birth, surrogacy, or adoption, should be treated equally. Family is family, no matter how it came to be. And while one may technically involve a medical procedure, all require adequate time with a new family member. The more time, the better. Please reconsider your current policy and allow for adoptive and birth parents and those who use surrogates to have the same paid leave time available should they need it. This is not a question of what Beecher is legally obligated to do because of FMLA. This is what Beecher should do because it's the right thing to do for your teachers, some of whom who can't have a biological child. These teachers should not be punished by forcing them to return to school to work sooner or risk losing money, something biological parents would not have to worry about. Adoptive parents are still parents, regardless of whether or not they gave birth. Please provide them equal opportunity to use the same amount of their paid leave. Failure to do this speaks volumes. I am also, I didn't realize there was an issue with MAG. I am a MAG parent. My daughter graduated from MAG. It's no coincidence that there are a lot of MAG people here that are supporting Kim because this is what the MAG community is about. Diversity, acceptance, being part of the community. MAG does not focus on just them, just their classroom. It focuses on the community as a whole, the world as a whole. And I think if you look at the kids that graduated from MAG, they're leaders in the community. They may not have started out as leaders, but MAG made them into leaders. And MAG taught them that they can do it. Not only can they believe they can do something, they do it. This last graduating class, I don't have the statistics, but I know a few of the kids. One went to Yale, one is at Cornell, and a couple of them went to Tufts. That's just from one small class. So MAG has a place in this community. Please fund it appropriately. Thank you.
Shane Frankfurt? Shane?
I'll defer to the end. I'll hold my comment to the end.
Okay. Jill Rostrom? Jill?
Oh. I also, well, I'll just come up for a second. Hi, Jill Rostrom, 5 Mansville Road. I also would like to say that I do not need the time that I signed up for because thank you very much for giving Kim and Annabelle their time that they, a little bit over, that they needed, and we appreciate that. I do not need to defer my time. Thank you.
Thank you. James Hubbard.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As many of you are likely aware, one of the treasured teachers here at Beecher Road School is preparing for well-deserved retirement. I'm glad to offer a perspective that only a handful of parents of current MAG students have. As former student of Mr. Bernessis, who many of us fondly refer to as Mr. B, I wish to bring to light the most significant parts, in my opinion, of this venture. While MAG did not yet fully exist when I was a student, there were some underlying key components to Mr. B's approach to teaching that play a vital role in the way in which the MAG group is run. Each student is a unique person with unique upbringings, and interests. Recognizing this, it is impossible to press each student into a mold and expect them to fit, especially at the elementary school level. The mold must be made to fit each child, recognizing their strengths and utilizing them in such a way that their, quote, weaknesses are seen from the perspective of traditional education, become irrelevant or even benefits. Mr. B has a very distinct talent for this. And while it is not unique, it is rare. The other MAG adults seem to carry this perspective as well, and I feel that to continue the MAG tradition, our community needs another classroom leader who shares this view. All parents carry different interests and talents, but what happens when a couple who has no interest in hands-on skills like carpentry and sewing have a child who wants to learn about these things? How many accidents happen in DIY projects gone wrong because people attempt things with little or no education about how to safely perform these tasks? How many first through fourth graders know which way to turn a screwdriver or how to use a handsaw? We all live around the things created by talented individuals with unique and innovative contributions to society, but few of us know how they work. Having children learn these skills starting at a young age is a great way to sow the seed of innovation and technical skill required to help continue to drive these further advancements that America is recognized for. Couple this with the respect given to each child for their passion and ideas, encouraging them to learn by doing, and we have a very strong component so often missed in modern education. Now, an extremely important part, which often is covered in school, but not in a seemingly hopeless manner. I've heard so many doom and gloom dissertations throughout my education in reference to how badly we as a modern society are treating the environment we live in and our gross neglect for the living beings that share it with us. How great a place would this be if we could have a classroom in which students are tasked with projects directly tied to environmental conservation and awareness? How great would it be if students could not only learn about the perils that our environment faces, but that they can and do make a difference? This is MAG, and each of the adults bring their talents to bear in this ongoing tradition. I hope that the next MAG adult member will hold our environment in high regard and continue this tradition with the other MAG adults. Another remarkable thing about MAG is how the students are all leaders in the group. Each is given the opportunity to voice their opinions in classroom, and with gentle nudges from the adults are given nearly free rein over the classroom activities. How an educator of young children can keep pace while allowing this is truly amazing to me, but this is done regularly in MAG. The sit down and listen to teacher approach of the old days is secondary here, and each child is given the opportunity to be a bold little leader with guidance from the adults to assure their success in their ventures. Classroom meetings are held in a manner representative of organized business meetings, where each is a peer, respected by their colleagues and giving the same respect when it is their turn to listen. I can't think of a better way to encourage respect, build confidence, and prepare the young mind for a successful future. All of these things and more were a core part of Mr. B's leadership when I was a child in second grade. And from what I see, through my daughter's attendance in MAG, this has been expanded upon with like-minded adults collectively contributing to the MAG tradition. Each person I have contacted from my class over the past week or so have held their experiences in B1 near and dear, and I personally remember my second grade year as the one that gave me direction in life. I sincerely hope this position will be given very distinct attention, as well as those of the other MAG adults when they are ready to move into their respective, well-deserved retirements. I forgot to state my name and address. My name is James Hubbard. I reside at 47 Morris Road in Woodbridge. And on the subject of adoption, I am also an adopted parent, and I definitely support the idea of ensuring that a new adopted parent has adequate time to properly bond with their child. Thank you.
Jeffrey Townsend.
I reside at 49 Grouse Lane. Woodbridge, Connecticut. And I've come here today to talk about Mrs. Franklin's request for support from the school for its district for her adoption. In particular, I'm going to make basically three arguments for supporting her in the way that she's asked. The first is an anecdote. The second is a moral argument, which will be very short because it's already been made quite well, I think, already. And the third is a dry calculation kind of argument. So that'll be the most fun. The first argument is just, I'm going to go by anecdote of my own story because that's an easy way for people to understand the kind of thing you're trying to express to them. So the story is, when I grew up in a family that through various machinations ended up being a very mixed family. That is, we had a lot of different people coming and going into our family. When I was young, we had many, many fresh air kids coming from the city, and they would come to live with us. I grew up with a father who was a teacher, and a mother who mostly took care of the home, but we also had a small farm, and we raised our own food, about 80% of what we ate. The consequence was, in the summer, both my parents were free to be parents to us in a full-time way, as well as maintain the farm, but also they could take on new people. So they would take on fresh air kids every summer. They would also take on foster kids during the summer. And the thing is, because both parents could be there, they could really devote time to these kids who were always in transition. And I saw, even as a kid, how stressful it was for those kids to move from one place to another. And these are kids who are moving from neighborhood areas to neighborhood areas. They're not international travelers. And they needed all the time that my parents could give them, every time that they came into our family. And my parents did a fantastic job of it. And that lasted for many years. I eventually also had a foster sister. I never had any adoptive siblings, so I can't speak to adoption in and of itself. But all I know is that all of those children who passed into my home benefited enormously. And in a way that I can't express, I can't imagine how it would have worked for them if there weren't the level of resources in terms of the parent availability during the transition time when they came into our home. So that's the argument I want to make on the basis of anecdote. On the basis of morality, I think we really ought to think, I just want to preemphasize that I really think as a district that we should be thinking in a forward way towards these kinds of questions and not in a way that harks of times that I think all of us can hope can pass away from now. That is, we need to think about these things like pregnancy and childbirth and adoption in terms that treat everyone on an even scale and don't discriminate on the basis of sort of older conceptions of how things used to be or used to be considered. Now, I know in the particular case of the Family Medical Leave Act, there's a lot of complexity to it because the particular distinctions that have been made historically in order to fit pregnancy into some sort of category, and therefore we need to consider it, you know, part of a of illness, disability, I don't know. But those categories, I think everyone knows it was placed in that category because you needed a category for it. And I think we can all see where this is going in the next couple of years, and in the next 10 years, and in the next 20 years. It's going to a place where people are not going to think of pregnancy as something that is equivalent to an illness. Pregnancy is something that is equivalent to taking care of a child. Those are very different things, and I think we need to think of them on a scale that places them evenly. Whether or not we consider this particular situation or any other situation, every situation we do. So that's my moral argument for it. And then the last is a dry calculation. And that is that there's no way I can actually do that. I'm a biostatistician, so I often think about making these calculations. And we do some pretty amazing calculations sometimes. I'm pretty happy and proud of what we do in trying to figure out what the optimal way to treat a disease is, the optimal set of ways that we should, you know, apply a sort of set of criteria so we can calculate cost effectiveness for various different ways of treating diseases. And what amazes me from time to time whenever I do these studies is how incredibly useful sort of an ounce of prevention is in the long run in making your budget balance. So if you're thinking in terms of budgeting, in the end, if you think about the benefit to the teacher who is taking care of kids in this district, the benefit to the child who will be later in this district, the benefit to everyone around, the benefit, and the last is the morale, the benefit on morale to the teachers in the school itself, in seeing that everyone is being treated in a fair way and equally in the circumstance of having a new child come into their family. I think that the raw calculation of whether or not one should support this, just like any other case of a child entering a family, says that we should support it just like every other case of a child entering a family. And that's all I have to say.
Hi everyone, my name is Mary DeCilio. I live at 3 Blue Trail Drive in Woodbridge. And while I'm not a lawyer or an expert in human resources, so I cannot comment on the wordage of the contract that you use, I feel that I'm an expert in being a mother of an adopted child. And also I'm a licensed clinical social worker at Yale New Haven Hospital, and I work on the maternity floor. And on a weekly basis, at least, I work with DCF, the Department of Children and Family Services, regarding neglect and abuse and having to remove children and put them in foster care. So on those two fronts, I feel that it would be very hard-pressed to find a social worker who would feel that 2 weeks would be sufficient to bond with a baby. And I don't know if there are any pediatricians here and if they will speak, but the pediatricians who I work with, they cannot envision that working very well to only have 2 weeks with a baby. And while there are probably people in certain circumstances who could take 2 weeks pay and then the rest without, there are a lot of families who cannot do that. And so, kind of like the last speaker, I feel that it would be cost effective to the school to give those extra weeks to not only Ms. Franklin, but to everyone who's in the situation, because I think it raises the risk if a child is not able to bond properly with a parent or a foster child, because you could easily have a teacher here who gets a call from DCF in the middle of the night saying, saying that there's a distant family member who cannot bring their child home because they're using drugs, a new mom, and they were listed as a responsible family member, and can they please take the baby? That you're gonna end up with children who end up needing special education or other special services because in the beginning of their life, they were not given that time to really form those bonds. And also, like the last speaker, I know for myself, if I had to go back to work 2 weeks after adopting a baby, it would be a disaster. I would not be able to concentrate and do my job properly. And I know my sister was a teacher for over 20 years that you can't even go to the bathroom sometimes as a teacher when you want to. At least I have the ability, if I did have to go back to work after 2 weeks, to go sit at a computer periodically, go to the cafeteria, have a cup of coffee. Teachers don't have that ability. So I cannot imagine a teacher really being able to be effective and being a good teacher to those 18 or 15, 20 kids. So I just think it just doesn't make sense. So thank you.
My name is Myra Zhang, and I'm a MAG parent for fourth grade and first grade, and hopefully a future one. I'm here to voice my concerns regarding the replacement position for MAG founding teachers in Mississippi who will retire this June. MAG is unique. It emphasizes hands-on project-based learning that not only provide a more interesting learning environment, but also it's flexible to meet where the student's level are. It not only teaches the student knowledge, but also the process, how to find the solution to building on lifelong critical skills, on critical thinking, problem solving, self-learning, and collaboration in teams. I'm very grateful for what Mac has provided my two kids, who with very different personalities. To build in this learning experience Mac students enjoy, the Mac teachers do go extra miles. From the way the Mac gardens during summer break, to shopping over weekends, for student cooking class, to taking an hour parent-teacher conference instead of 20 minutes, to providing stretching learning opportunity fitting for the students. Since the Mac teachers do this with a passion and a belief that their work will shape the students' future in the years to come. A teacher for Mac as a replacement to Miss B will not only need the basic teaching credentials, but also need to have the same passions and the belief to carry Miss B's work forward. Assign a random teacher to replace Miss B without his or her initiative to seeking this opportunity will not only not fair for the people put into that position because they need to do extra work without believing in it. It's also not fair for the ATE Mac student and their family who believe in Mac philosophy. Such a move will also be detrimental to long time viability of Mac as our beloved Miss B going on retirement. So I'm here to urge you to allow the searching process to continue to identify a willingly place replacement for the position Miss B emptied upon his retirement. Thank you very much for your support.
Good evening, I'm Michelle Ditzian, 10 Timber Lane in Woodbridge. I'm speaking tonight as a Woodbridge resident, a mother of three real children, Ben, Sophie, and Reuben, all of whom we adopted. I'm also speaking as a veteran teacher and a guardian ad litem for children in placement in Connecticut. On June 15, 1998, when our eldest child joined our family, I was teaching in a northern suburb of Chicago, very similar to Woodbridge. I took maternity leave on June 7th and stayed out for the rest of the year using sick days I had accumulated through my years of teaching. I took the following year as an unpaid leave. No one ever mentioned that I might not be entitled to those benefits because I didn't give birth to my child. My colleagues threw a baby shower before we left and met us with balloons at O'Hare when my husband and I arrived from Korea with our 6-month-old boy. That was 1998, still years before my gay colleagues could obtain health insurance through the district for their same-sex partners. I'm using my phone as a timer, but I have to admit I'm always checking it. In our family, we have text groups for different levels of news. When Sophie had a car accident last week, I learned about it on a group called Sophie Plus Parents. When I wanted to brag that Reuben was elected president of his class at Flat Tech, I used a group we call Family Wide. I think it has 17 members in 3 different states. But when we want to use the nuclear option, in our family that's mom, dad, and the 3 kids, there's a group called The Real Family. Sophie created it, not just because we're hopeless with our phones, but as a response to all the people who have asked her over the years, who's your real mother? Don't you want to find your real family? She might one day. But Sophie, Ben, and Reuben know that this is their real family, whether they decide to learn more about their birth family or not. Our family didn't become real like the bunny and the Velveteen Rabbit after a long time in which eye buttons are lost and stitching becomes loose. Real families are born all at once in a little explosion, whether that be birth or homecoming. And that little explosion is something that requires recovery. Call it bonding, call it regaining equilibrium. Adoptive families need it every bit as much as birth families. As a guardian ad litem for children in this state who are not in the custody of their families, children who don't always feel safe and who don't always feel loved. I want you to see how positively impactful we can be. If everything we do and say fosters family bonding, we do a good thing as a society when we provide the necessary time and resources for a family to become a solid entity. We do a great thing when, as towns, schools, community organizations, places of worship, sports teams, and social media groups, we communicate to children that their families are legitimate and, yes, real, no matter how they happen to come together. Please make sure that all parents are treated equally under the Board of Education's policy for parental leave. It's the first step to making sure that the children are treated equally. Thank you.
You are the end.
Have that comment at the end of the session.
No. Oh. At the end of the meeting?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
All right.